Hi, this is Samya Ravindran and welcome back to my channel Infinity for UPSC. And today we are going to cover the last chapter of ancient history, which is buildings, paintings and books. This is the timeline. Please pause this and go through this timeline. Now today in this lecture, we are going to cover the buildings, paintings and books which were written during this time period. That is the post-Mauryan era, from the time of Cholas, Cheras, Pandyas till the time of Chalukyas and Pallavas. So this is the time period that we are going to have a look at in this chapter. As we had seen, this chapter, it discusses the buildings, the paintings and the books. So we are beginning with the iron pillar. This iron pillar, it is placed at Mehroli, which is in Delhi. So iron pillar, Mehroli, Delhi. Now why is this iron pillar so important? Because it has not rusted till this date. It was made about 1500 years ago, that is 500 AD, and till date it has not rusted. And several scientists from across the world, they have come to India to study the metallurgy of this iron pillar. That is how this iron pillar was built. So that means the knowledge of metallurgy was very good among the ancient Indians. They had very good knowledge about metals and the use of metals. Then this iron pillar, obviously it was made of iron. It is 7.2 meters in height and it weighs over 3 tons. And it probably belonged to the Gupta dynasty, because we have got a name which has been inscribed on top of this pillar, and the name is Chandra. And we assume that it is Chandra Gupta from Gupta dynasty. So iron pillar, it belongs to Gupta dynasty. It is at Mehroli, Delhi, and it has not rusted till date, made about 1500 years ago, that is 500 AD. Ancient Indian metallurgists had made major contribution to the metallurgical history of the world. I have told you that people across the world, they have come to India to study this iron pillar so that they get a glimpse of the knowledge which was used behind making this iron pillar. Archaeological excavations have shown that Harappans were master craftsmen and they had knowledge of copper metallurgy. So Harappans, even those people had very good knowledge of copper metallurgy, and this period, it is called as Bronze Age. Harappan period, it is called as Bronze Age because they had the knowledge of copper, they had the knowledge of tin, and they also had the knowledge that mixing copper and tin will give bronze. So that is the reason Harappans were called as Bronze Age people. Then the successive age, that is the Vedic age to Mahajanapada's era, is called as Iron Age. India produced highly advanced type of iron, forged iron, wrought iron and cast iron. So this says that India has produced highly advanced type of irons. Buildings made of brick and stone. We had just seen a building which was made of iron, that is the iron pillar at Mehroli, Delhi. Now we are going to see some buildings which are made of brick and stone. First is a stupa. Now this stupa, this is something which is associated with Buddhism. And stupa, this basically is a mound. While there are several kinds of stupas, there are certain common features to these stupas. And what are those common features? First of all, they have a relic casket which has been placed at the center of the stupa. And within this relic casket, we have got body remains of Buddha or his followers. So body remains inside the casket, and this relic casket, this is placed at the center of the stupa. Then we might also have the things which these people might have used. That is the things used by Buddha or his followers. Plus we might also have some precious stones and coins within this relic casket. So body remains, things that they used, and precious stones and coins. All these things are placed inside the relic casket and it is placed at the center of the stupa. Then further, this relic casket, it is covered with a layer of mud brick or baked brick, and at times this is also covered with carved stone slab. That is, first a layer of mud brick or baked brick is added, and then on top of that we have got carved stone slabs. Then outside this mound, we have got Pradikshinapath. What is a Pradikshinapath? It is a path which surrounds the stupa. That is, the devotees are supposed to move around the stupa across this path, and that is called as Pradikshinapath. So the devotees, they walk around the stupa in a clockwise direction as a mark of devotion to Buddha or Buddha's followers. So that is Pradikshinapath. Then this pradakshina path, it is further surrounded with railings. We know that the purpose of railings is that people should move in a particular order and they should not move here and there. So pradakshina path, then railings. And then we have got entrance to this path through gateway. So we have got a gateway which is an entrance to this path. And the railings, the gateways, all these are decorated with sculpture. So we have got relic casket, we have got pradakshina path, we have got railings, then gateways, and all these are decorated with sculpture. So this is one example of stupa. This is the great stupa which is built at Sanchi, Madhya Pradesh. So the semicircle thing that you see, this is the mount, this is the gateway, then this is the pradakshina path, it is surrounded with a railing, and the relic casket, it is placed within this mount. So it is placed inside this mount. Stupas like this one were built over several centuries. That is, one king might have started the construction of this stupa and it might have taken forward by the further kings. So this particular mount or this particular stupa, it was constructed by Ashoka, but the railings and the gateways, these were added during the time of later rulers. So Ashoka, he started the construction of the great stupa at Sanchi, Madhya Pradesh. So great stupa, Sanchi, Madhya Pradesh and Ashoka. So you need to remember all these things together. Then further, this stupa, it might have built about 2200 years ago, because this was built by Ashoka, and Ashoka, he existed during 200 BC. Now we are in 2000 AD, so 2200 years ago. Next is sculpture from Amravati. In this place also we had a stupa, and this stupa might have built about 2000 years ago. So a magnificent stupa existed in Amravati. And Amravati, this is in Andhra Pradesh. So this is where Amravati is. It is in Andhra Pradesh. Many of the stone carvings for decorating the stupa were made about 2000 years ago. Other buildings were hollowed out of rock to make artificial caves, and some of these were elaborately decorated with sculptures and painted walls. So a hollowed out cave existed in Amravati, and we had a magnificent stupa at Amravati which was built about 2000 years ago. Then certain Hindu temples, that is the earliest Hindu temples, were also built at this time. And the deities such as Shiva, Vishnu and Durga, they were worshipped in these shrines. Now we have got certain features of Hindu temples. Those are, first is Garbhagriha, then we have got something called as Shikhar, and then Mandapa. So what is a Garbhagriha? It is the most important part of the temple, and within this Garbhagriha, we have got the chief deity. That is, the chief deity is placed within this Garbhagriha and the priest performs religious rituals within this place. So that is Garbhagriha. Then we have got Shikhar. Shikhar, it is a tower which is built on top of the Garbhagriha. That is, it marks that this is a sacred place. So Shikhar, it serves as a signpost and it suggests that this is a sacred place. And we get to see the example of one of the oldest Shikhars at Bhitargaon. So Bhitargaon, example of one of the oldest Shikhars. Then further, building Shikhars required careful planning. That is, very good knowledge of geometry plus knowledge of making sculpture. Both were required in making these Shikhars. Then we have got something called as Mandapa. Mandapa is an open space or a hall where people could assemble. So Mandapa, open hall where people assembled. So we have seen Garbhagriha, the place where the deity was placed, Shikhar, signpost, Mandapa, hall where people could assemble. Then some of the finest stone temples were built in Mahabalipuram and Aihole. So note this word, stone temples. So stone temples were built in Mahabalipuram and Aihole. And this is Mahabalipuram in the map. It is in Tamil Nadu. So Mahabalipuram, it is a coastal town located in Tamil Nadu. Then Aihole, whenever you see Aihole, you need to go back and remember the fact that Aihole is the capital of Chalukyas. So Aihole, capital of Chalukyas, and in these two places, that is Mahabalipuram and Aihole, we have got some of the finest examples of stone temples. Mahabalipuram, coastal town in Tamil Nadu, Aihole, capital of Chalukyas in Karnataka. So this is the example of Shikhar. This is the temple at Bhitargaon, Uttar Pradesh. So Bhitargaon, Uttar Pradesh, and one of the earliest examples of Shikhar. It was built about 1500 years ago and it was made of baked brick and stone. Then these are the monolithic temples at Mahabalipuram. So Mahabalipuram, we have got examples of stone temples. And what is the meaning of monolithic temple? Monolith means something which has been carved out of a single piece of stone. That means all these temples are made out of single piece of stone. And that is the reason these are called as monolithic temples. Now there is one speciality in terms of constructing monolithic sculpture. What is that? While ordinary constructions are made from bottom to top, that is if you are making something out of stone or brick, you will place one brick on top of another brick. That is, the construction is from bottom to top. Whereas in case of monolithic structures, the construction is always from top to bottom. So monolithic temples are found at Mahabalipuram and this is the example of stone sculptures or stone temples. Then this is another temple which has been carved out of stone and this is Durga temple at Aihole, which was built about 1400 years ago. So Durga temple, Aihole, made out of stone and built about 1400 years ago. How were stupas and temples built? First of all, they needed good quality stone. So they had to find good quality stone. Those had to be quarried and transported to the place where they wanted to build this stupa or temple. So that is first step. And then they had to shape and carve these stones into the required pillars and panels. Second step, then these were to be placed in precisely the right position. So this is how the stupas and temples were built. And the resource required or the money required, it was spent by kings and queens, because those days building stupas and temples were very expensive and only kings and queens had the money that was required to spend to build these architectures. So it was probably the kings and queens who spent the money, and they spent money from their treasury. Then we also get to see some examples of devotees spending the money, but they are just spending a portion of money that is required to build these kind of architectures. Example, we get to see that an association of ivory workers, they had paid for one of the beautiful gateways at Sanchi. We had just seen a stupa which was built at Sanchi, and now we get to see that an association of ivory workers, they had paid for one of the gateways at Sanchi. So some contribution were made by other people as well, but most of the resource was spent by kings and queens. Then we also get to see that the ordinary people like merchants, farmers, garland makers, perfumers, smiths, and hundreds of other men and women, they have contributed to building such stupas and temples. And we get to know that these people have contributed because their names have been inscribed on pillars, railings, and walls. So that is how we get to know that these people have contributed in the making of these architectures. Then this is the example of a Jaina monastery which is from Orissa. So here we get to see two-story building which was carved out of rock surface. And there are several rooms. So in these rooms, the Jaina monks lived and they meditated. So this is an example of Jaina monastery from Orissa. Then this is another piece of sculpture which has been placed at National Museum which is in Delhi. Now this shows that how the caves were hollowed out. Hollowed out in the sense, I have already told you, some caves are not natural caves, those are artificial caves, and those have been created by hollowing out some rock surface. So this is how the work was done. They had something like knife and they were hollowing out this rock surface. Now looking at this, we can say that it might have probably taken months or years to hollow out these caves because they are using very simple tools. Next is painting. So we are done with the first part of the chapter, that is building. So we have seen several kinds of buildings. First was metal buildings, that was iron pillar. Second is made of bricks, that was the stupas which were found at Sanchi. Then we had seen architectures which were made of stone. Example, temples at Mahabalipuram and at Aihole. So we had seen monolithic temples at Mahabalipuram and temples made at Aihole which were made of stone. Now we are coming to paintings. So painting, the best example of those days is found at Ajanta. And Ajanta, where is it? So this is Ajanta in map and it is in Maharashtra. So Ajanta, Maharashtra, and one of the finest example of paintings of those days. Ajanta is a place where several caves were hollowed out of hills over centuries. So again, we find lot of artificial caves in Ajanta, that is in Maharashtra. We had seen one such example, that was Karle Caves in Maharashtra. So that was a hollowed out cave. Most of these were monasteries for Buddhist monks. So Ajanta, you need to associate with Buddhism. But please note that it says that most of these were monasteries for Buddhist monks. That means there were other architectures or sculptures which belonged to other religion as well. And some of these monasteries were decorated with paintings. As the caves are dark inside, most of these paintings were done in the light of torch. Torch in the sense fire torch. So basically here the author is trying to convey to us the difficulty that was involved in painting and the difficulty that was involved in building the sculpture. Further, the colors which are vivid even after 1500 years, that means this was painted about 1500 years ago. And these colors, these were made of plants and minerals and it is even now vivid, that is even now it is very clear. The artist who created these work remain unknown. That means we do not know who all have created these paintings. So they are unknown. So painting at Ajanta, Maharashtra, most of them belong to Buddhism and it was created about 1500 years ago. So these are the examples of paintings from Ajanta. Next is the world of books. So we are done with the first part and the second part, that is the buildings and the paintings. Now we are moving on to the books. Some of the best known epics were written during this period. Now what is an epic? Epics are grand, long compositions about heroic men and women and include stories about God. So this is the definition of epic. And a famous Tamil epic called Silapadikaram, it was composed by a poet named Ilango about 1800 years ago. So that means 200 AD. So Tamil epic Silapadikaram, Ilango and time period is 200 AD. You need to remember all these things together. Now what is the theme of this story? It is a story of merchant named Kovalan who lived in Puhar and fell in love with a courtesan named Madhavi, neglecting his wife Kannagi. So three characters, Kovalan, husband, wife, Kannagi, and Madhavi is a courtesan whom Kovalan loved. Now later, he and Kannagi, that is husband and wife, they left Puhar and they went to Madurai where he was wrongly accused of theft by the court jeweler of Pandya king. That is, the husband and wife left Puhar and went to Madurai, but there he was wrongly accused of theft by the court jeweler of Pandya king. Then later, the king sentenced Kovalan to death. And his wife, that is Kannagi, she still loved him and she was full of grief and anger at this injustice and she destroyed the entire city of Madurai. Now destroyed in the sense, it is said that she cursed the entire city of Madurai and that is how the entire city of Madurai got destroyed. So this story is still well known among the people in Tamil Nadu and they consider Kannagi as the epitome of love, devotion and chastity. And she is still respected and worshipped in Tamil Nadu. So what are the important keywords? Tamil epic, Silapadikaram, poet, Ilango, composition 200 AD and characters Kovalan, Kannagi and Madhavi. Now here we see two places, that is Puhar and Madurai. What are the things that we know about these two places? Puhar, it has got one more name and that is Kaveri Patnam. It is the port of Cholas. Madurai, this is the capital of Pandyas. So this is Puhar and Madurai in the map. Puhar, it is located on the coast, that is on the eastern coast. And this is Madurai. This is also on the eastern part, but it is not a coastal town. Now here we see one more thing and that is Pandya king's reference. Now we have learnt about Pandya king. So Pandya king ruled between 200 BC to 200 AD. And we can see the time period of the composition of this epic. It is 200 AD. So obviously Pandya king was ruling the southern part of India. See here, Cholas, Cheras and Pandyas, they ruled between 200 BC to 200 AD, that is 2200 and 1800 years ago. A description from Silapadikaram, that is a small portion of this entire epic is given here. Now here the wife, that is Kannagi, she is expressing her grief and she is saying that the sword of king is used for the murder of innocent strangers. Is there no God? So this is a question that she is asking. Is there no God in this country? Now we know that he was not that innocent. He was not a loyal husband. Obviously, he did not commit the crime of theft, but he was not an innocent person. Next is Manimeghalai. Again, this is a Tamil epic. We had already seen one Tamil epic, that was Silapadikaram. Now this is Manimeghalai. It was composed by Satanar around 1400 years ago, that is 600 AD. That was 200 AD, this is 600 AD. This describes the story of daughter of Kovalan and Madhavi, that is husband and the courtesan. So Kovalan and Madhavi's daughter. These beautiful compositions were lost to scholars for many centuries, but finally it was rediscovered about 100 years ago, and that is how it was available to the scholars for reference. So Manimeghalai, Tamil epic composed by Satanar, time period 600 AD, and the main character is daughter of Kovalan and Madhavi. Other writers such as Kalidasa wrote in Sanskrit. So far we have seen two epics and both were in Tamil. One was Silapadikaram and second one is Manimeghalai. Now we are going to see the work of Kalidasa. So Meghadoot, this is Kalidasa's best known poem. In this poem, a monsoon cloud is imagined to be a messenger between lovers who are separated from one another. So Meghadoot, Kalidasa's best poem, and the theme is a monsoon cloud which is acting as a messenger between two lovers who are separated from each other. Now here you have been given a small portion of this poem, that is Meghadoot's small portion has been given here, and in this section the poet is describing the breeze that will carry the cloud northwards. So that is the description which has been given here. Next is recording and preserving old stories, that is Puranas. So far we had seen three epics. One was Silapadikaram, then Manimeghalai, then Meghadoot. First two, both were in Tamil. Third, that was in Sanskrit. Now we are going to see about Puranas. A number of Hindu religious stories that were in circulation earlier were written down around the same time. That means all these stories were known to people, but it was written down during this time, similar to the case of Vedas. We had seen that Vedas, all those were composed earlier, but it was written down at a later point of time. Now here, when they are saying that it was written down around the same time, that means it was written down during the time of post-Mauryan period. So that is the meaning of written down around the same time. Now Puranas, as the name suggests, it means old. So Puranas, the meaning is old. Now Puranas contain stories about gods and goddesses such as Vishnu, Shiva, Durga or Parvati, and it also contains the details about how these deities should be worshipped. And it also contains stories about the creation of world and also about kings. So it contains stories about gods, about kings, about how these gods are to be worshipped, and about the creation of world. So all these things are given in the Puranas. Then further, these Puranas were written in simple Sanskrit verse. We had already seen that the Vedas, those were written in old Sanskrit verse, which was very difficult to read and to comprehend. Now this is written in simple Sanskrit verse, and it was meant to be heard by everybody, including women and Shudras. We already know that during the later Vedic period, women and Shudras, they were not allowed to read Vedas or even listen to Vedas. But during the Rig Vedic period, that is during the Vedic era, some of the women had even composed the hymns. That is, those restrictions did not exist during the Vedic period, but it existed during the later Vedic period. Now again, during this time period, that is during the post-Mauryan era, when these Puranas were written, those restrictions were again lifted and Puranas were allowed to be read by women and Shudras. These Puranas were probably recited in temples by priests and people came to listen to them. So it was recited publicly in temples so that everybody could hear Puranas. So here the important point is, it was written in simple Sanskrit verse, time period is post-Mauryan period, and it could be heard by everybody including women and Shudras. Next is two Sanskrit epics called Mahabharata and Ramayana. So Mahabharata and Ramayana, again these two were popular for very long time, but it was written down during this time period. So similar to what Vedas and Puranas were, even these Mahabharata and Ramayana were known to everybody but written down during this time period. So here you need to understand the difference between composition and compilation. Composition in the sense the story has been conceived, the story has been framed, that is, it is conceived in your mind, it is there. But compiled in the sense it has been written down so that it is available for others to read it. So that is the difference between composition and compilation. Now coming to Mahabharata, it was about a war which was fought between Kauravas and Pandavas, who were cousins. This was a war to gain control to the throne of Kurus and the capital Hastinapur. Now this is what is given in your textbook, but that is not true. The war was fought for the dignity of the queen called as Draupadi. So that is the actual reason behind the Mahabharata war. The story was an old one, but it was written down about 1500 years ago, that is 500 AD. Then both Puranas and Mahabharata are supposed to have been compiled by Vyasa. So Purana compiled by Vyasa, Mahabharata compiled by Vyasa. Then Bhagavad Gita, this was part of Mahabharata. We had already seen about Bhagavad Gita. There was a dialogue between Arjuna and Krishna. We had discussed about that dialogue as well. Then coming to Ramayana, it is about Ram, who was the prince of Koshal, who was sent into exile. His wife Sita was abducted by the king of Lanka named Ravana, and Rama had to fight a battle to get her back. He won and returned to Ayodhya, the capital of Koshal. Now basically, when you look at the themes of these two stories, that is Mahabharata and Ramayana, both were fought for the dignity of the women. Okay, so that is the importance of these two epics. Both were fought for the dignity of the women. Like Mahabharata, this was an old story and was now written down. That is, during this time period, it was written down. Now here they have pointed out that Valmiki is recognized as the author of the Sanskrit Ramayana. There were several versions of Ramayana, and Ramayana was written down in several other local languages. And the difference between Sanskrit Ramayana and the other famous Ramayana is the ending is different. The climax portion of this Ramayana and the other Ramayana is entirely different. And the Sanskrit Ramayana is believed to have been the original Ramayana, and the author is Valmiki. So Sanskrit Ramayana, author Valmiki, and here the author is, or the compiler is, Vyasa. So Mahabharata and Purana, Vyasa, Ramayana, Valmiki. Now if you look at this slide, we see two places which we had seen already. That is Kurus and Koshal. We had seen these two somewhere. Where was that? These two are Mahajanapadas. So Kuru, this was a Mahajanapada, and Koshal, even this was a Mahajanapada. Kuru, capital Hastinapur, and Koshal's capital during this time period was Shravasti. But here we see that Koshal's capital is Ayodhya during the time of Ramayana. So here Koshal capital Ayodhya, and here Koshal capital Shravasti. Next, stories told by ordinary people. So far we had seen Silapadikaram, Ilango, and it was in Tamil. Then Mani Meghalai, Satana, and that was in Tamil. Then Meghadut, that was composed by Kalidasa in Sanskrit. Then we saw Puranas, Mahabharata and Ramayana, all were in Sanskrit. And Purana and Mahabharata, these were compiled by Vyasa, and Ramayana by Valmiki. Now we are moving on to stories told by ordinary people. So here we have Jataka's collection and Panchatantra collection. So even these two were written down during this time. So Jataka's, Panchatantra, and time period is post-Mauryan period. Stories from Jataka's were often shown on railings of stupas and in paintings in places such as Ajanta. So very important statement, stories from Jataka's were painted in Ajanta. Stories from Jataka's were painted in Ajanta. Remember this point, very important. The story of the Monkey King. So this story, it has been taken from the Jataka tales, and it has been painted on the walls of Ajanta caves. Now what is this story talking about? There are two kings, one is a monkey king and another a human king. And they are showing the difference between the attitude of these two kings towards their subjects and towards the innocent and helpless creatures. So this great monkey king, he lived on the banks of Ganga in the Himalayas with 80,000 followers. And all these monkeys, they were feeding on a special mango tree. And this was very sweet, and it was not available on the plains. That is, it did not grow there. But once a ripe mango fell into the river and it reached up to Varanasi. Now this human king, he was taking bath in this river and he tasted this mango. He liked that mango very much and he wanted to find the tree from where this mango has fell down. So he asked his people to go and find the tree. And they found that this tree is in Himalayas and they discovered that the monkeys, they were also feasting on the fruit. Now this human king, he did not like that monkeys were also feasting on the fruit which he liked. So he decided to kill all these monkeys. Now when the king of the monkeys, when he got to know that the other king has decided to kill all these monkeys, he made a plan to save his followers. So he created a bridge across the river and he allowed all the monkeys to move from this part of the river to the other part of the river. But finally this monkey king, he was exhausted and he fell down and he died. Now this human king, he was seeing all these things and he felt very bad and he tried to revive the monkey, that is bring him back to life. But he was unsuccessful and he mourned the death of this monkey king. Now this human king, he understood the difference between the attitude. That is, this human king, he decided to kill all these innocent creatures because he wanted to enjoy more mangoes. And this other king, that is the king of monkeys, he was ready to give up his own life to save his followers. So look at the difference between these two attitudes. So now, since the human king learned a good lesson from this monkey king, he decided to carve out a sculpture depicting this story. Now this sculpture has been carved out so that others can also learn something from this monkey king. So that is the importance of this sculpture. It has been found at a stupa at Bharuch in central India, taken from Jataka's story, and the painting has been carved on the walls of Ajanta caves. Next is books on science. So this was the time when Aryabhatta, a mathematician and an astronomer, wrote a book in Sanskrit known as Aryabhattiyam. So Aryabhatta, he wrote a book called as Aryabhattiyam and this book is in Sanskrit. Now in this book, he has given us three facts. First is, he said that day and night were caused by the rotation of Earth on its axis. Second, he gave the scientific explanation for eclipses. Third, he gave us the formula to calculate the circumference of a circle. So all these three are explained in Aryabhattiyam and this was written in Sanskrit. Then apart from Aryabhatta, we also had Varahamihir, Brahmagupta, Bhaskaracharya. And these three were mathematicians and astronomers. And these three had made several discoveries and all those were written down in books and that was during this time period. So post-Mauryan period, we had Aryabhatta, Varahamihir, Brahmagupta and Bhaskaracharya. Then other important discoveries which were made during this time period were Zero and Ayurveda. So Zero and Ayurveda, these were the two important discoveries which were made by India and these were the important gifts which were given by India to the world. While numerals had been used earlier, mathematicians in India now invented a special symbol for zero. Now this is how it has been written in your book. It says that a special symbol for zero was invented. Now if you read this, it appears that zero was already existing but they did not have a symbol for zero and now Indians gave the symbol for zero. That is not true because this concept of zero, that did not exist at all. And the people, they were counting up to 9 and they were repeating the count from 1 to 9 again. So that is how they were counting and they did not know this concept called zero. So this was invented by Indian and this was adapted by Arabs. So Arabs adapted it from Indians and the Europeans felt that this was invented by Arabs. So for a long time, Europeans believed that Arabs invented zero, but later, that is during the modern period, everybody got to know that this invention was made by Indians. So that is how the credit was given to Indians. It continues to be in use throughout the world. So zero, gift of India to the world. Now another gift of Indians is Ayurveda. Ayurveda is a well-known system of health science that was developed in ancient India. Two famous practitioners of Ayurveda in ancient India were Charak and Sushrut. Now look at the timeline. Charaka is 1st to 2nd century AD. CE means AD. Sushrut, he is 4th century AD. So first is Charaka, then came Sushrut. Now coming to Charak, he has written a book called as Charak Samhita and this is a book on medicine. Have you seen this name earlier, Charak? Yes, we had learned about Charaka Samhita in the 4th chapter. And there we saw that as per Charaka Samhita, human body has got 360 bones, but this is incorrect. So now modern scientists, they say that it is incorrect, but it is not incorrect, it is correct. Because during those days, that is when Ayurveda system of medicine existed, body was divided into Sapta Dhatus. And among the Sapta Dhatus, one Dhatu was Asthi Dhatu. And in Asthi Dhatu, teeth, joints and cartilage, everything is included. And when you count teeth, joints and cartilage, you get 360 bones. So the figure is absolutely correct. So this was when we saw the Charaka Samhita. Now we are seeing one extra book, and that is Sushrut Samhita. This was written by Sushrut. He lived during 4th century AD. So Sushrut Samhita, it gives us details about surgical procedures. Now there is a very popular misconception that ancient Indian Ayurveda deals only with medicine and not with surgery. So that is incorrect. Sushrut Samhita, it has got elaborate procedures detailing surgical methods and surgical equipments. Now I will give you an account of one incident which was mentioned in a medical journal. And this medical journal, it was published in US and in European countries. So there they had given a reference about an Indian person who was conducting surgery on the roadside. And that person, he was not a doctor by profession or he did not have a degree in medicine, but he was conducting surgery. And the most surprising fact is that he was conducting a surgery between the jawline and between the neck without cutting the jawline. That is, he had made a small hole between these two points, and that is how he was conducting the surgery. And this method, it was not known to any of the scientists or any of the doctors. So when the doctors got to know that, they came to visit this person and they learned the method from this person. And they asked this person that how did he get to learn about this method, because he is not a professional doctor or he did not have any degree in medicine. So that is when this person suggested about Sushrut Samhita. He has read this book and that is how he got to know about different procedures, and that is how he is conducting surgeries on people. So this interview and this surgical method, it was published in the European Medical Journal. Next is elsewhere. During the post-Mauryan period, when these buildings, these paintings and when these books were written in India, what was happening in China? Paper was invented in China about 1900 years ago by this person. I do not know how to pronounce this name. This person has invented the technique to make paper. He beat plant fibers, cloth, rope and the bark of trees, soaked these in water, then pressed, drained and dried the pulp to create paper. And this is exactly how paper is made even today. The technique of making paper was a closely guarded secret for centuries. So again, they had kept this thing as secret for centuries. We had seen about the silk, that was also kept as a secret for centuries. Then later it reached Korea about 1400 years ago and then spread to Japan. In Baghdad, it was known about 1800 years ago, and from Baghdad it spread to Europe, Africa and other parts of Asia including the Indian subcontinent. So a very important discovery made by Chinese. Some important dates. Beginning of stupa building 2300 years ago, that is 300 BC. Then we saw something at Amravati. What was that? We saw that once a magnificent stupa existed at Amravati, and this stupa, it was decorated with stone sculptures. Now why is it that we are repeating whether a particular sculpture has been made out of stone or out of brick or out of wood? It is because we should know that 2000 years ago, the sculptures were able to carve out of stone. That is, their skill was extraordinary and the techniques that they were using, all those techniques were also extraordinary. That is the reason we emphasize that these were sculpted out of rock. So Amravati, a magnificent stupa with stone carvings. Then Kalidasa's time period was 1600 years ago, that is 400 AD. Then we saw iron pillar, and this was at Mehroli, Delhi, and the time period is 1500 years ago, that is 500 AD. Then we saw a temple at Bhitargaon. What was the importance? The importance is this is one of the temples with shikhar. So one of the oldest example of temple with shikhar, and this was at UP. Then we saw paintings at Ajanta, even this was 500 AD. Then Aryabhatta, his time period was also 500 AD. So all these events took place together. Iron Pillar, Temple at Bhitargaon, paintings at Ajanta and Aryabhatta's time period. Then we saw Durga Temple, that is 1400 years ago, 600 AD. Now what is the importance of Durga Temple? We saw two finest examples of stone temples. One was Mahabalipuram and other was Durga Temple at Aihole. So this Durga Temple, it is at Aihole, and the other one, that is Mahabalipuram, that is a monolithic temple and both are made out of stone. So Durga Temple, the time period is 600 AD. And note that this is the order. The stupa building began first, then Amravati's case, then Kalidasa, then Iron Pillar. But in this chapter, we had learned about Iron Pillar first because that was the most important thing that we should know. So that is the reason we learned about Iron Pillar first. But this is the order. Now we are going to revise about all the important events in ancient history. That is from chapter 1 to chapter 11. Now pay absolute attention. So the beginning of farming and herding at Mehrgarh, it dates to 6000 BC. Now C is used. C means circa in Latin and this means approximate. That means approximate dates have been used throughout the book. Now the first important event is the beginning of farming and herding at Mehrgarh. This is 6000 BC. That is 8000 years ago. Now I will be showing you the exact slide where we have seen that event because dates are represented in two different ways. One is giving you the exact BC or AD date and another is telling you how old this event was. That is 1600 years ago or 8000 years ago, that way. And more than that, we see some date in context to something. That is, we see that date in a statement. So we will be able to recollect that date better if we see that entire statement again. So I will be showing you the slide once again where we had read these events. So Mehrgarh, this is one of the hunter-gatherer sites and it is a Neolithic site. And Mehrgarh, this is in Pakistan and this is the location. Then we saw that Mehrgarh was probably one of the places where people learned to grow barley and wheat and rear sheep and goats, and it is one of the earliest villages. Now in this slide, they have not given us the date, but now they are telling us that it was 6000 BC or 8000 years old. Now when I am showing you the entire slide, the particular event is marked in red and I will be reading this part only. But you are supposed to pause the slide and read all the other important statements. That is Mehrgarh, this is near Bolan Pass, and we have found bones of deer, pig, sheep and goat. And we have got remains of square or rectangular house with four or more compartments, and people in Mehrgarh, they believed in life after death. So you are supposed to revise all the statements which have been marked in bold. So that is the purpose of showing you this entire slide so that you can revise the entire ancient history part. Now apart from Mehrgarh, we had also seen about Sulaiman and Kirtar, and this is also in Pakistan. And here they have specifically given that crops such as wheat and barley were grown for the first time about 8000 years ago. So this is also in Pakistan and almost the same location. So Sulaiman Kirtar ranges and Mehrgarh, almost same location and almost same history. Next is Harappan cities flourished between 2700 and 1900 BC. Now this is not years ago, this is BC. So now let us see. These cities developed about 4700 years ago. So 4700 years ago means 2700 BC. So here we see 2700 BC. This is the beginning. Then end is 1900 BC. And here we had seen that around 3900 years ago, we find the beginning of a major change. So 3900 years ago means 1900 BC. So that is what we see here, 1900 BC. So this is the reason I am giving you the exact statement so that you do not get confused between dates. Next is the Rig Veda was composed between 1500 and 1000 BC. I have striked out this word composed because we have already discussed that Rig Veda was composed centuries ago and it was written down later. So this date is not correct, but we will go by this date for the sake of our exam. So here we had seen that it was dated to 3500 years ago. So 3500 years ago is 1500 BC. So that is what we see here. Then here I had mentioned about the true characteristics of Vedic period, and here I had stated that it was composed at least 10,000 years ago. Then the next important event is Mahajanapadas emerged in 500 BC. So here we saw that 2500 years ago, some Janapadas became more important and they were known as Mahajanapadas. So 2500 years ago means 500 BC. Next, during the same time period, cities developed in Ganga Valley. So this is also 500 BC. Where did we see that? We saw that in first chapter, about 2500 years ago, cities developed on the banks of Ganga and its tributaries and along the sea coast. So this was 500 BC. Then during the same time period, Buddhism also emerged. So the time period of Buddhism, 500 BC. Siddhartha Gautama, the founder of Buddhism, was born about 2500 years ago. That is 500 BC. So here we see 500 BC. See, you are supposed to pause this slide and read all these things. That is, Buddha belonged to Sakya Gana. He was a Kshatriya. Then enlightenment at Bodh Gaya in Bihar. Then taught for the first time at Sarnath near Varanasi. All these things, you are supposed to read it. I won't be reading all the things. I will be reading only the important events. So please pause and read everything. Next, Upanishads were also developed during this time period. So Upanishad, 500 BC. Here we had seen that around the time that Buddha was preaching, some thinkers tried to find answers to difficult questions related to Atman and Brahman. And this was nothing but the development of Upanishads. Then next, we saw that Vardhaman Mahavira also emerged during this time period and Jainism became popular during this time period. So Jainism, 500 BC. See, here we had seen that the last and 24th Tirthankara of the Jainas, Vardhaman Mahavira, also spread his message around this time, that is 2500 years ago. Now you should understand that all these events are related because with the development of Mahajanapadas, cities developed, and that is the reason we find cities in Ganga Valley. Then with the development of Mahajanapadas, people wanted to oppose the system which was existing in Mahajanapadas, and that is the reason these thinkers, they came up with Upanishads, Jainism and Buddhism. So all these are reaction to the Mahajanapadas, that is the development of Upanishad, Jainism and Buddhism. Next is Alexander invaded the northwest part of Indian subcontinent around 327 BC, or for convenience we can say that 300 BC. So here we had seen that more than 2300 years ago, a ruler named Alexander, who lived in Macedonia in Europe, wanted to become world conqueror, and he had reached up to the bank of Beas, but he got scared. He and his soldiers got scared after seeing the elephants and after seeing the strong rulers in India, and they refused to move further. That is the reason they went back. Next is Chandragupta Maurya becomes king, and this is 321 BC. So here we had seen that the empire that Ashoka ruled was founded by his grandfather Chandragupta Maurya more than 2300 years ago, that is around 300 BC. Then came Ashoka, and he ruled between 272 BC to 231 BC. Now if we go back to this book, we cannot find any reference to any of the time period related to Ashoka. The only thing that we can find is 8 years after becoming king, Ashoka conquered Kalinga. But the date of this Kalinga war is not given, and the date of he becoming king is not given. But that doesn't mean that we do not know the dates. We know the dates, but I'm just telling you with reference to what we have learned so far. So far, we do not know any time period related to Ashoka. But here at the end of the chapter, they say that Ashoka ruled between 272 BC to 231 BC. So remember this time period. Next is the composition of Sangam text, and this is 300 BC to 300 CE. CE means AD. So 300 BC to 300 AD. So that means it took around 600 years to compose this text. So here we had seen that some of the earliest works in Tamil known as Sangam literature were composed around 2300 years ago. So that means 300 BC. And here we see that it was composed between 300 BC to 300 AD. Then next is the reign of Kanishka. That is the time period when Kanishka ruled. This is 78 to 100 CE. CE means AD. And here in chapter 9, we had seen that Kanishka, he ruled 1900 years ago. That means 100 AD. And here we see it is 78 to 100 AD. Next is the establishment of the Gupta Empire, and this is 320 AD. And here we had seen that Kanvas and other rulers, they ruled till the establishment of the Gupta Empire about 1700 years ago. So 1700 years ago means 300 AD. So here we had seen 320 AD. In chapter 10th, I had already given you the precise date, that is Gupta period. It existed between 320 AD to 550 AD, and that is what we see here. Next is compilation of Jaina texts at a council at Vallabhi, and this is 512 AD or 521 AD. Now here we have got two dates, that is because historians are not able to agree on a particular date. So 512 AD or 521 AD. Here we had seen that they were written down at Vallabhi in Gujarat about 1500 years ago, that is 500 AD, and here we see that it is approximately about 500 AD. Next is the rule of Harshavardhan, and the time period is 606 to 647 AD. Harshavardhan, he ruled nearly 1400 years ago, that means 600 AD, and that is what we see here, 600 AD, Harshavardhan's time period. Next is Hyun Zhang comes to India, 630 to 643 AD. Here we had seen about Hyun Zhang, he came to India around 1400 years ago, that is 600 AD, and that is what we see here, 600 AD. Next, the rule of Pulakeshin II, 609 AD to 642 AD. Now if we go back to this book, we cannot find any date related to Pulakeshin II. But we know the fact that Pulakeshin II checked the advance of Harsha. And we know that Harshavardhan, he ruled nearly 1400 years ago, that is 600 AD. So Pulakeshin II's time period should also be 600 AD. So that is what we see here, rule of Pulakeshin II, 609 AD. And we also see that Harshavardhana and Pulakeshin II, they are contemporaries of each other. So the time period is similar, 606 AD and 609 AD. So we are done with the revision of all the important events in ancient history. Now in the end of this chapter, we have got a political map of India, but we will be discussing this map in the map series. So there I will be discussing this entire map. Now let us revise this entire chapter once again. We will do that in 5 minutes very quickly. So Iron Pillar, location Mehroli, Delhi, time period 500 AD, and this belongs to Gupta dynasty, and we know this because Chandra, this name has been inscribed on the pillar. Then the Harappans, they belong to the Bronze Age, and their successors belong to the Iron Age. Their successors in the sense Vedic Age to Mahajanapadas. So that entire time period is called as Iron Age. Then coming to stupa, stupa means mount. There is a relic casket which has been placed at the center of the stupa. Then we have pradakshina path, railings, gateways, and all these are decorated with sculpture. Then we saw the great stupa at Sanchi, Madhya Pradesh, and this was built by Ashoka, but the later part was added by the later rulers. Then we saw the sculpture from Amravati, and this was a place where a magnificent stupa once existed. And we have found stone carvings which are as old as 2000 years. This is the location of Amravati, it is in Andhra Pradesh. Then the important characteristics of Hindu temples are Garbhagraha, here we place the important or the chief deity. Then we have got Shikhar, this is the signpost. Then we have Mandap, this is the hall. And we find examples of Shikhar at Bitargaon, UP, and examples of stone temples Mahabalipuram and Aihole. Mahabalipuram, monolithic temples, and Aihole we have found Durga temple. This is the location of Mahabalipuram. It is a coastal town in Tamil Nadu, and this is Aihole. So Aihole is here in Karnataka. This is one of the earliest example of a temple with Shikhar, Bitargaon, UP, and the time period is 1500 years ago. It was made of baked brick and stone. Then these are the monolithic temples which was found at Mahabalipuram. The important characteristic is it has been built from top to bottom. Then this is the Durga temple at Aihole. The time period is 1400 years ago, made out of stone. The money required to build the stupas and temples were given by the kings or the queens, but at times devotees and ordinary people also contributed. And the example is beautiful gateway at Sanchi. This was contributed by an association of ivory workers. Then another example of stone carving, this is a Jaina monastery from Orissa and carved out of stone. Next, this sculpture which has been placed at the National Museum in Delhi, it shows how caves must have been hollowed out. Then one of the earliest and one of the finest example of painting has been found at Ajanta, and the colors are vivid even after 1500 years. The colors were made of plants and minerals. So these are the paintings from Ajanta. And Ajanta, this is the location, it is in Maharashtra. Then coming to books, we saw a Tamil book called as Silapadikaram, and the poet is Ilango, time period is 200 AD. The characters are husband, wife and courtesan, that is Kovalan, Kannagi and Madhavi. And we find a reference to the court jeweler of Pandya king. The cities mentioned in this are Puhar and Madurai. Puhar has got one more name, and that is Kaveripatnam. It is the port of Cholas. Madurai, this is the capital of Pandyas. And this is the location of Puhar. It is a coastal town in Tamil Nadu. And this is Madurai. Again, this is in Tamil Nadu, but it is not a coastal town. Then we also saw that Cholas, Cheras and Pandyas, they ruled between 200 BC to 200 AD. That means when Silapadikaram was composed, these people were ruling the southern part of India. Then another Tamil epic, Mani Meghalai, composed by Satanar, time period is 600 AD. The main character is the daughter of Kovalan and Madhavi, that is husband and courtesan. Then we find reference to another writer called Kalidasa, and he wrote in Sanskrit. And the best known poem of Kalidasa is Meghadut, and the theme is a monsoon cloud which is acting as a messenger between lovers who are separated from each other. Then we find that Puranas, which existed since a long time, that was written during this time, that is during the post-Mauryan era. And Purana, it means old. It is written in simple Sanskrit verse, which was meant to be heard by everybody, including women and Shudras, and it was recited publicly in temples by priests. Then coming to Mahabharata and Ramayana, even these are very old epics, but these were written down during this time period. So two Sanskrit epics, Mahabharata and Ramayana. And Mahabharata, it talks about Kurus, and their capital is Hastinapur. Time period is 500 AD, that is the time when it was written down. And Puranas and Mahabharata, these were compiled by Vyasa. And I have also told you the difference between composition and compilation. Composition is creating something new. Compilation is writing it down. So that is the difference between composition and compilation. So compilation of Puranas and Mahabharata by Vyasa in 500 AD. Then Bhagavad Gita, this was also included in Mahabharata. Then coming to Ramayana, here we find the reference of a place called as Koshal. Rama, he was the prince of Koshal, and he comes back to Ayodhya, which is the capital of Koshal. And the author of Sanskrit Ramayana is Valmiki. So this is Kuru, the capital is Hastinapur, and this is Koshal, and the capital here is Shravasti, but during the time of Ramayana, the capital was Ayodhya. Then coming to stories told by ordinary people, we find reference to Jatakas and Panchatantra, and the stories from Jatakas have been painted in places such as Ajanta. And this is one such example, the story of Monkey King, this has been painted on the walls of Ajanta. And this story, it is also shown in a sculpture which was found at a stupa at Barhud in central India. Then coming to books on science, we saw that Aryabhatta, who was a mathematician and an astronomer, he wrote a book called as Aryabhatyam in Sanskrit. And we find reference to other mathematicians and astronomers like Varahamihir, Brahmagupta and Bhaskaracharya. So all these people lived during this time period, that is post-Mauryan era. Aryabhatta, Varahamihir, Brahmagupta and Bhaskaracharya. Then we saw that Zero and Ayurveda was invented by ancient Indians during this time period, that is post-Mauryan era. And Zero, it was adapted by Arabs and spread to Europe and later to the rest of the world. Ayurveda, we saw about Charaka and Sushrut. And Charak, he existed during 1st and 2nd century AD and Sushrut 4th century AD. The book written by Charak is Charak Samhita. It is a book on medicine. Then the book written by Sushrut is Sushrut Samhita. It gives you details about surgical procedures and surgical equipments. And I have also told you about an incident which took place in India, and because of which we got to know the importance of Sushrut Samhita. Then during this time, that is during the post-Mauryan Empire, paper was invented in China about 1900 years ago. Then these are the important dates. Beginning of stupa building 2300 years ago. Magnificent stupa found at Amravati 2000 years ago. Kalidasa's time period 1600 years ago. Then iron pillar at Mehroli, Delhi. Temple at Bhitargaon, UP. Paintings at Ajanta. Aryabhatta's time period, all these are 1500 years ago. Then stone temple at Aihole, that is Durga temple, 1400 years ago. So these are the important dates which we saw in this lecture. So that's all from my side. We are done with the entire portion of the ancient history. Now, from the next lecture onwards, we will start with the medieval history. So please like, share and subscribe this channel, and I'll be back with the next video very soon. Thank you so much.